morning and welcome once again to First Parish Church Congregational in beautiful Manchester by the Sea, Massachusetts, on this Sunday morning, this third Sunday in the sacred season of Advent, that time in Christian spiritual tradition where we wait and prepare for the arrival of God coming to us, the child who would grow up to be our brother and teacher and Lord. First Parish Church Congregational, the congregational part of our name, representing our long-standing tradition within Christianity, democratic governance, and the full equality of all members of this spiritual community to participate in its life and work, which means that I welcome you here to this place where no matter who you are or where you are on your life or spiritual journey, you are fully welcome. One more note before we begin with the lighting of the Advent candles. I need you to write down the phone number, because we're going to use it a little bit later during the morning's message. So write this number down, 908-477-5426. 908-477-5426. We'll get back to that a little later in the morning. I am Reverend Dr. Mark Boyea, the minister here at First Parish Church Congregational, and on behalf of our worship team, I once again welcome you and invite you now to participate in the lighting of our Advent candles. Let us share these words from Psalm 96. Let the heavens be glad, and let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar and all that fills it. Let the field exult and everything in it. Then shall all trees and forests sing for joy before the Lord, for he is coming. The lighting of the candle of joy, we proclaim the joy God offers to all creation, a joy so vibrant it lights a path from the heavens to earth and back. It is the joy of Jesus, the one whose coming offers us. God's light brings joy, and where there is joy, there is light. I welcome you now to join us in the singing of our opening hymn, We Hail You, God's Anointed, the words of which are printed in your online bulletin.
Thank you.
take hold of and trust in your Advent promise of hope, love, and joy through him. The promise of new and better life for us and all your people. We pray all this in the name of the one we wait for and offer you the words he would one day teach his followers to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. It is now my great pleasure to welcome First Parish's new Director of Youth and Children's Ministries, Gene Westcott, to come aboard.
Good morning. Well, I thought I'd tell you a little bit
out of concern for our sisters and brothers in need, these tangible gifts and blankets. We know that while you are always with them, a physical reminder from others can bring a measure of hope and healing to those who struggle and suffer. And so we pray that these blankets will provide not just material, but emotional and spiritual comfort as well. So we pray, O God, may those who receive these blankets sense the love and care put into them as a sign of our and your love and care. Feel the warmth of your Holy Spirit as they wrap themselves in them. Know your presence in the prayer they have been blessed with, a prayer which goes with them, and may they be a beacon to those who receive them, a sign that they are not forgotten. Hearts and minds and spirits as they continue the work necessary. hearts and minds all teachers and students and school leaders, as well as all those who are continuing to contract and suffer from COVID-19 throughout this nation, throughout the world, as the cases have now once again continued to rise dramatically. Also, ask you to hold in your thoughts and prayers all those who are working in warehouses and driving delivery trucks in every season, but especially during this time of COVID Christmas, just as we have been keeping in our hearts and minds grocery store workers and folks like that during the earlier part of this pandemic. These folks also do not have the possibility of working from home or working remotely in any other way, and so we hold them in our thoughts and prayers as they carry out their duties to help satisfy our needs for the most part. With those things, I now welcome you to add any other joys or concerns, any other prayer intentions that you might have. Share them with whoever you might be with at this time, or simply offer them up to our God in the silence of your hearts. Eternal One, you have created us to know hope. You have created us to know peace. You have created us to know joy. But you have not just created us to know those things, to feel them. You have created us to be those things, to be peace, to be hope, to be joy. And so we ask you to lead us to them. Open us up to them. Make them the foundation of who we are in the world and in others' lives. Help peace and hope and joy to grow inside us to the point where they can no longer be contained, but instead flow into every aspect and occasion of our lives. Not just the ones that make us feel happy, but also the ones that bring us feelings of anger and sorrow and disappointment and shame. Grow your hope, peace, and love inside us, O God, to the point where they lift us up above whatever our circumstances. Lift us up to sing and dance in spirit when the world or others try to silence or ground. house on the hill. Uzzah and Ahio, sons of Abinadab, led the new cart which had the ark of God on it. Ahio was walking in front of him. David and all the Israelites were celebrating in the presence of the Lord. They were playing wooden instruments, lyres, harps, tambourines, rattles, and cymbals. Then David danced with all his might before the Lord. He had on a holy linen vest. David and all the Israelites shouted with joy and blew the trumpets as they brought the ark of the Lord to the city. As the ark of the Lord came into the city, Saul's daughter Michal looked out the window. And when she saw David jumping and dancing in the presence of the Lord, she hated him. David put up a tent for the ark of the Lord, and then the Israelites put it in its place inside the tent. David offered whole burnt offerings and fellowship offerings before the Lord. When David finished offering the whole burnt offerings and the fellowship offerings, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord all-powerful. David then gave a loaf of bread, a cake of dates, and a cake of raisins to every Israelite, both men and women. Then all the people went home. David went back to bless the people in his home, but Saul's daughter Michal came out to meet him. She said, "With what honor the king of Israel acted today. You took off the clothes in front of the servant girls of your officers like one who takes off his clothes without shame." Then David said to Michal, "I did it in the presence of the Lord. And the Lord chose me, not your father, but anyone from Saul's family. The Lord appointed me to be over Israel. So I will celebrate in the presence of the Lord. Maybe I will lose even more honor, and maybe I will be brought down in my own opinion, but the girls you talk about will honor me." So this may take a couple minutes longer than normal, because we're going to do something a little bit different. We're going to start with a question, and not the rhetorical kind, like I often start these times with, and then explore throughout the rest of the message. Today we're going to start with a question that I actually want you to respond to now. Remember that number I asked you to write down during the welcome? 908-477-5426? Well, in a moment, I want you to text your answer to this question to that number. And then after that, we'll look at those responses, along with the responses I've already gotten to the question, because I sent it out to First Parish's email list a couple days ago, and have already received some responses. So, here's the question, and then you're going to have a couple minutes to think about it and respond while Herman, being the good sport that he is going to bring us a little additional Christmas joy. Question is, what is your favorite Christmas movie? What is your favorite Christmas movie? Text your answer to 908-477-5426. You've got a couple of minutes while I'm in place. It's a Wonderful Life, How to Grinch Stole Christmas, A Charlie Brown Christmas, Love Actually, Holiday Inn, Christmas Carol, It's a Wonderful Life, The Scrooge with Alistair Sims again, The Christmas Story, Home Alone, The Grinch Who Stole Christmas with Jim Carrey, White Christmas, The Santa Claus, It's a Wonderful Life, Christmas Carol, Miracle on 34th Street, Joy to the World, Christmas Story, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. Quite a variety. And mine? Well, I gave you a small clue, because the song that Herman played, Santa Claus is Coming to Town, is sung near the end of my favorite Christmas movie by the character Jody, played by the actor Zoe Deschanel. You know what it is, right? Elf. Elf. And if you're not familiar with the movie Elf, or have not seen it, Elf is a whimsical comedy starring the prolific actor and comedian Will Ferrell in the title role. The story is about a baby. Baby growing up in an orphanage, who one Christmas Eve crawls into Santa's sack and accidentally ends up at the North Pole, where the baby is then raised by Papa Elf, played by one of my comedy heroes, Bob Newhart. Buddy is the name given to the child, and Buddy is raised as an elf, which goes okay for a while, until Buddy, the human, grows up to be about 6'3", at which time things get a bit complicated. Some of the other elves begin to grumble, and one day, Buddy overhears them say that he is not an elf, but a human. And so Buddy goes to Papa Elf to find out what his story is. Papa Elf tells him what happened at Christmas Eve. He tells Buddy that his parents had been unmarried and unable to care for a child at that time in their lives. Papa Elf also lets Buddy know that since that time, his mother has died, but that his father is a children's book publisher in New York City, a man by the name of Walter Hobbs, played by the great James Caan. Papa Elf encourages Buddy to go and find Walter, but also cautions Buddy about Walter. Tells Buddy that his father has become not the most joyful person on the planet. Become a bit jaded, a bit bitter, as well as someone who seems to be far more concerned with his own self-oriented ambitions than anything else in life. But, like any good elf, Buddy is undeterred. He makes his way to New York City and finds Walter. But from the time he first comes face to face with Walter, until the night of Christmas Eve, Buddy receives nothing but disappointment and discouragement and anger and rejection from Walt. But then, near the end of the movie, on the night of Christmas Eve, because Buddy has persevered, he does two things. He helps save Christmas Eve, but more importantly, he helps save Walter. He helps save Walter's sense of decency, Walter's sense of kindness, Walter's sense of generosity. Buddy helps save Walter's spirit. How? Joy. Through joy. Because Buddy is a relentlessly joyful person. He is joyful from start to finish in the movie Elf. He is joyful even when he is experiencing those feelings of discouragement and disappointment, the anger from Walter, when he is experiencing the feelings of rejection. Buddy is still a joyful person, even when he is unhappy. Wait, aren't pool, dances with all his might as he brings the Ark of the Covenant into Jerusalem for the first time. The Ark of the Covenant was an oblong wooden box about 5 feet long. And in it was stored the two stone tablets on which the Ten Commandments were written. The stone tablets God gives Moses on Mount Sinai. It was a gold plate on top of the Ark of the Covenant, and on each end was a figure known as a cherub. Cherubim was a figure that had the body of either a lion or a bull, the head of a human, and the wings of an eagle. They were considered sacred objects in the ancient world. And in the space between and above the cherubim, it was believed the presence of God existed. The presence of God resided. And so the Ark of the Covenant was the most sacred object in all of ancient Israel, ancient Judaism. And now David, the king, is bringing it to Jerusalem for the very first time as he establishes Jerusalem as the capital city. For a number of years, its whereabouts were uncertain. It had been captured in battle by Israel's most prominent and consistent enemy, the Philistines. But then finally David learns of its whereabouts and he goes to get it from the home of a guy called Abinadab, as we heard in the story. And as he brings it back into Jerusalem, there is music and singing. And David, we are told, is dancing with all his might. But is it the same? Is David dancing for the same reason that Buddy dances? As a state of being, a state of being known as joy. This translation, this Bible translation of this passage, indicates that it is related to joy. But most other Bible translations don't use the word joy here. And I get that. I get that. Because I'm not sure David dances out of joy either. Because throughout the larger story arc that these verses reside in, David exhibits more than once his greatest conflict. The greatest conflict that David has throughout the arc of the story in life. And David's greatest conflict is not with King Saul, his predecessor on the throne, who tried to kill him more than once when David became a threat to the throne. It's not with Saul, it's not with the dreaded Philistines either. David's greatest conflict throughout his life as he is presented to us in the Bible is just like it is for most, if not all of us. It is within himself. It is with himself. It is the conflict between David's sincere devotion to God on the one hand, and his sincere and often greater devotion to his own self-oriented needs and desires and wishes, particularly his desire for power, whether it's political or military or sexual. And in the story arc that surrounds these verses, that story is tinged with that conflict. See, the verses that we share are actually a synthesis. They are a synthesis of the two attempts David makes to bring the Ark to Jerusalem. And both of those end with avoidable death and failure. The first time ends with the literal death of Uzzah, someone faithful to God, and the failure of the Ark to make it to Jerusalem. A lot of that having to do with David's lack of care and concern for anything but his own needs, his own goals, his own personal ambitions, to just get the Ark to Jerusalem.
supposed to be given to the Ark of the Covenant, the rules, the traditions passed on by the priests in terms of how the covenant is supposed to be cared for and transported. And that lack of concern for either the well-being of others or for the presence of God leads to that death and failure. And then there is the second time. The time that leads to the death and failure of a relationship. His relationship with his wife, Emmanuel. As David dances in front of the Ark of the Covenant, as he brings it into Jerusalem, we are told that Michael, his wife, Saul's daughter, watches from the window and hates him. Other translations say despises him, holds him in contempt. She hates him. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that in her mind, in her heart, in her soul, she believes that David is not dancing but out of self-oriented ambition, out of a lack of true care and concern for God's higher ends, because she has experienced it. Michael has become like Walter, bitter, jaded, and understandably so. Once upon a time, she loved David. She loved David when her father Saul had promised her to David in marriage. But then, when Saul perceives that David has become too great a threat to the throne, he reneges on that promise and gives Michael to someone else in marriage. David doesn't object. David continues his pursuit of the throne. But then when David becomes king, he sends for Michael. But not because he loves her. He doesn't. He sends for her because he knows it will help him solidify his hold on the throne, that it will help possibly unite his supporters with Saul's former supporters. And Michael knows that. And so when David comes home after bringing the ark into Jerusalem, she lashes out at him. She lashes out and accuses him of doing his dancing and everything else simply from self-oriented ambition. And David, in response, really doesn't do anything to refute that. Because he responds sarcastically by just saying, well, hey, God chose me, not your father, not any of your brothers, to be king. So if I want to dance like that, I will. And whatever was left of that relationship dies. The very last verse of this passage says that Michael had no children for the day she died. But not for the same reason as Sarah and Elizabeth, who we talked about the last couple of weeks, women who were thought to be too old or unable to have children. That's not what we're told. We're simply told that Michael does not have a child until the day she dies. Because that relationship has died. And so has a lot of, if not all, of Michael's spirit. And it died from a lack of joy. It was too late for Michael and David. But it wasn't too late for Buddy and Walt. Joy can save. Joy can save a relationship. Joy can save the spirit. Joy can save us. And that is why joy is so much at the heart of Advent and Christmas. It's why joy is at the heart of the movie Elf. And it's why, while I have not seen every one of those movies that you mentioned, I've seen almost all of them. And I know, as you do, joy is at the heart of those movies too, just as it is at the heart of Advent and Christmas. The joy that makes it possible for us to maintain our sense of wonder in the world and in life, no matter how we feel. The joy that makes it possible for us to appreciate and celebrate the good fortune of others, no matter how we feel. The joy that makes it possible for us to sing and dance in life, dance in spirit, no matter how we feel. Dance with all our might, not
put this in challenge and call for our lives during the sacred season of Advent. I'd also like to thank our worship team for their leadership today, our musical leaders, Dr. Herman, Weiss, Rebecca Shrimpton, Paul Knox, and our technical leaders, Cindy Boyea and Kelsey Boyea. And so now, my friends, it is time for us to leave this sacred space and go out into the world committed to being joyful people, committed to the joy that God calls us to during Advent and Christmas and beyond, a joy that is a state of being, a state of being in the world and with others that is rooted in a deep commitment to God and God's higher ends, and a deep connection to others and the well-being of them and us. Let us leave this sacred space ready to be joyful people, because who knows?